Praise the Lord, everyone. I'm glad to have you joining us today. God bless you. And I believe that we're in for a good word today, as always. Praise God. And I believe you're going to be blessed by the word you hear today. However, before we get into that, I need to really give a real God bless you and shout out and thank you to the Full Gospel Word and Worship Center family. You did a marvelous thing. I thank you for all the surprise that came to me on my birthday this week. And it was such, in fact, I'll be honest, it was the best surprise of my entire life. I really, really thank you and appreciate everything you did. A parade, praise God, of cars coming down the street with placards saying, you know, happy birthday, and all that you did. It was amazing. I was speaking with someone recently and they said they were blown away when they saw it on our page. And I said, I was blown away. I really was. It was just amazing. I'm still reeling from that gesture. It was great. It was great. I couldn't hug everybody and do all of those things, but praise God, you showed up, you were there, and you did what you did, and it was marvelous. It was marvelous. Praise God. And I want to thank all of those of you who were sending comments, and after you've seen it and you send in comments and all of the birthday greetings, happy birthday from everybody everywhere, I want to thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I was looking over some of those things, and there were people that really kind of stood out because of where they are, where they're from. You know, thank God I was looking at this woman, and I say a woman, but you know who you are, Joanne in Northern Ireland, and I saw your, you know, happy birthday greeting and your mother Ethel, and thank you. Thank you. I just want you to know that I saw it there. Joanne received such a powerful miracle from God just in 2017. God just did a marvelous thing with her and touched her and touched her mother as well. And we give God praise for that. I want to give a shout out to the Hall family also in Northern Ireland and all of those who tune in from Ireland and Northern Ireland, from Africa, wherever you're tuning in from. Also, those of you in the Beaufort area, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you, because a number of the people drove over 2 hours to come and be a part of this parade. It was great, and that meant a lot. But then there were a few others that were unable to come, but they put on their own down in Beaufort near our church. And with the same thing, so you had a mini parade there, praise God, and sent me the video of it. And I want to say thank you. So thank you, thank you, thank you 1,000 times, Full Gospel, for giving me the best birthday surprise of my life. God bless you. I love you. And bear with me in my folly for a moment. Like Paul said, bear with me in my folly while I boast for a moment. This is the best church in the world. Praise God. You are the best. I know that's a little carnal, but I did say bear with me in my folly while I boast. So I'm finished boasting, but you know, praise God. Praise God. So thank you. Thank everyone. God bless you. God bless you. And you know what I want to do also? I want to give a shout out to one other person who is the queen. And I'm talking about my wife. God bless you. God bless you. She is the one that put these things together, and with some help, of course. she comes up with these things, and I'm telling you, I just want to thank God I've got the best woman I can have. God bless you, and I love you. Thank you also. So now we're going to get into some things. I'll tell you now that I'm not going to be able to finish everything because we have so much to say. So we'll pick up next time on where we leave off today. Lord, say the same. And but anyway, I wanted to talk about some things, and let's pray before we get into it, and then we'll get right into this message. Father, we thank you for your holy word. Thank you because you are our very own Father, and we are your very own children. Thank you that we are saved and sanctified by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that we are filled with the Holy Ghost, who has been sent to be our teacher and to be our guide, to unveil the living word through the written word, to show us and guide us and direct us in the manner that we should go. Thank you, Father. I thank you also for utterance in the Holy Ghost. Thank you for what you have done and what you are doing at this moment. Thank you for speaking, as it were, through my lips and thinking through my mind and making my tongue, as it were, the pen of a ready writer. Thank you for the hearts of people being receptive and open. And thank you, Lord, for what people will learn and what they will take hold of, because many have suffered through not receiving answers to prayer as they desired and as they should. And it's frustrating. But I thank you, Lord, that people will receive answers today that will bring some clarity and help them to walk in that which is your desire. I thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Now, last Sunday, we were talking a little bit about being citizens of the kingdom of God and of Christ. And I did that because I said it was going to be a two-part thing. I wanted to talk about reasons why people fail to receive answers to prayer, and that's failure to receive healing or any other answer to prayer. And I wanted to talk about that, but last week I wanted to lay out something about the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God is a kingdom of laws. And I told you that God doesn't just arbitrarily do things. Everything that God does is based on law, certain kinds of spiritual law that he himself has established. So he has bound himself by the things that he established. Let me give you a quick example of a spiritual law that will help you understand what I mean. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Now notice that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's God's word. That's God's promise. Really, that is a law that has been established. If you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you receive him as your Savior, you will not perish, but have everlasting life. The flip side of that is, if they do not believe, then if whoever it is do not believe, then they are condemned. In fact, the scripture says, I quoted John 3:16, verse 17 says, "For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." So, he's not condemning you. Jesus didn't come to condemn you. But then the very next verse says, he that believed not is condemned already. But it's self-condemnation. You condemn yourself because you've not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And so a rejection of Christ means that you perish. It doesn't matter who you are. Doesn't matter what your name is. Doesn't matter who your family is. That's the way it is. It doesn't change. It's not based on your good works. It's not based on any of those things. So it does not change that fact That's an established spiritual law. You can really consider any promise that God gave you of something about how things work or how it will work out and all of that. This, he's laying it out. This is how it works. And so we're calling that a spiritual law, something that God established. A law really is a rule of action. This is a rule that governs how this action should be and what the outcome of this action is. It's a rule. If you want this, you have to do that. If you're going to have this, you must do that. You understand? So I'm calling it law. They are law because it's a rule of action. Now, we saw many things, and I want to go quickly over a couple of them again. I'll make mention of them. We'll not go read them all, but I want to just make mention of some passages that we looked at last time. But before we go into those passages, I want to go back to this fact. In Colossians chapter 1, where it talks about us being a part of the kingdom. I think that's important for us to go back to that. Colossians chapter 1, verses 12 and 14, reading the New King James Version, it says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed, that is, transferred us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Now, I want you to understand that we have been made citizens of the kingdom of God. Now, you're not a citizen of the kingdom of God just because you are on earth. You are not a citizen of the kingdom of God because you go to church. You're not a citizen of the kingdom of God because you pray. You're not a citizen of the kingdom of God because you read the Bible. What makes you a citizen of the kingdom of God is receiving the Lord Jesus as your Savior and Lord. That's what, when you are born again, now you are part of the kingdom and not before. You hear people say a lot of things. I hear people say all the time, we're all God's children. They're talking about all humans. We're all God's children. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says we are children of God by faith in Christ. By faith in Christ Jesus. That's how you become a child of God. You're not a child of God just because you're on earth. You're not a child of God because you're human. You're not a child of God because you was born. To be a child of God, you got to be born again. That's how you're a child of God. And when you do become a child of God like that, the scripture says, for as many as believed him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God or the children of God. And when that happens, then automatically you were delivered from the authority of darkness or of Satan and transferred into the kingdom of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So it's the kingdom of God, it's the kingdom of Christ. So we are now a part of that kingdom. Now we talked a lot about that last Sunday, so you can go back and watch that. But the point that I made and was making is that because we're now a part of that kingdom, let me put it like this. If you are a citizen of the United States and you move to Ireland or you move to some other country, doesn't matter where you move, if you become a citizen of that country, now you're governed by the laws of that country. Doesn't matter what it is. You're not governed by the laws of the country that you left. You are governed by the laws of the country that you now occupy, that you live in, and that became a citizen of. Well, it's the same thing. We are governed by the laws of the kingdom of God because we are now members of his kingdom. We are citizens of his kingdom. And so our laws come from the Word of God. And what we have to do, if we're going to operate and successfully in this life and be and have the things that God desires to have and have the blessings of God and enjoy the blessings of God as we should, we're going to have to do it on the basis of His laws, the kingdom of God laws. Well, the kingdom of God is spiritual, and so are the laws. And we have to govern ourselves accordingly. Now, for instance, faith is a spiritual law. It is a law. And when we understand the law and how it works, then we can understand how to make it work for us. Now, some people have, you know, people have a lot of interesting ideas about God that are completely unscriptural. A lot of ideas. And this is one of the reasons why people fail to receive. Now, I've heard people say a lot of things about God. Well, the Lord knows what I need. And in His own time, I'll get it. Have you ever heard anyone say that? Sure you have. I've heard that many times. The Lord knows what I need, and when He gets ready in His own time, He will give it to me. Well, first of all, the Lord is not going to get ready to do anything because He doesn't have to get ready because He's ever ready. That's number one. Number two, God knowing your need or knowing you have a need does not mean that you automatically have that need met. We're talking about how things must be done. Jesus said in one place, He said, your Father knows what things you have need of, now notice, before you ask Him. Notice you still got to ask Him. He knows that you have need of these things. He knows what things you have need of before you ask. See, we're talking about how the kingdom of God works. Just because He knows doesn't mean you're going to receive anything. He doesn't have a time set aside to answer you or to meet your need. That is something that people believe, but they cannot substantiate it by the Word of God. God doesn't have a time that He's going to decide that He's going to answer you. And He doesn't have a time that He's going to do something for you no matter what. No matter what you do, no matter what happens. I've said it before, and I'll say it again, that there is a God side and a man side to everything we receive from Him. There is a God side and a man side to everything we receive from Him. God doesn't do the man side, and you can't do the God side. As I use as an example before, the scripture says, you know, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. The believe that you receive them is the man side. That you shall have them is the God side. But you have to believe that you receive them. If you don't, then it doesn't work because that's what the law is. The law is believe that you receive and you shall have. If I don't believe that I receive, I'm not going to have. It's not just a matter of God knowing that I need it, and so He's just going to do it for me. And people pray this way because, you know, and it's not a criticism, it's just an observation, but people pray this way as a result of not knowing the Word of God. You know, we looked at it last time where Peter talked about it. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace is multiplied through knowledge. If you don't know the Word, you're not going to be at peace. And to the degree you know the Word, to the degree that you have knowledge of God's Word, it's to that degree that you're going to have peace. It's to that degree you're going to have grace or favor. It's to that degree. It's not just automatic. It comes as a result of knowledge. And sad to say, but true, many And I believe most Christians don't have much knowledge about the scripture because we do not study as we ought to. We don't study as we ought to. We don't spend the time in the word that we ought to. People in false religions are more studious about what they believe and about their religion and so forth. And we have the word of God, the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me. You can't come to him except you can't come to God, his Father, the Father, without coming through Jesus. That's true in coming to him to have your sins forgiven, but that's also true in coming to him in prayer. You can't come to him except through Jesus. That's how you gotta come, through Jesus. That's what Jesus said. So that means that he said it, that's the law. He's the king of the kingdom, and whatever he says is the law of the kingdom. It is the rule of action. It talks about how this works. It doesn't work any other kind of way. God can't just decide he's going to feel sorry for you and do something because he sees that you're in need. No, that's not the way it works. It works, and he is God of love. He does love us. He is compassionate, and he has mercy, and all those things. But things happen for a reason. It's not just arbitrary actions on God's part. They happen. God responds to prayer. God responds to things, to his word, to what his word says. And so when you hear someone say, well, God understands what I need, and when he gets ready, I'm going to get it. That's one of the reasons why you've been waiting so long and you haven't gotten it yet. And you're going to keep on waiting because it's not going to happen because it doesn't work that way. Your Father knows what things you have need of before you ask him. Here's something else Jesus said that I found interesting. He said, the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Now think about that for a minute. The harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. And then he says, pray ye the Lord of the harvest, that is God, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. But wait a minute. Whose harvest is it? It's his harvest. Why do I need to pray that the Lord will send forth laborers into his harvest, since it's his harvest, while he just do it? Because the law of the kingdom works as such. There are things that need to be done, but God needs you to pray in order for it to come about. There are some things that happens in this world that is not according to the will of God. There are things that happen to you that are not according to the will of God. Some people make the mistake of believing that if God, quote, allow it, then it's somehow his will for it to happen. Well, if you come to the corner in your town, come to the street corner, and you want to walk across the street, you don't stop, you don't look for traffic, you don't look at the light, you just come to the street and run across the street. Well, there may be a car that comes by and hit you. It may even kill you. It's not because, and you can say, well, God allowed that to happen. Well, let's take the same person coming to the same corner, but this time they stop and look and make sure it's safe to go across, and then they go across safely. God allowed that to happen. Now, which one is his fault? It's not about it being his fault. It's not about his will. He allowed what you allow. Just because something was, quote, allowed does not mean it is his will. And so the idea that if God allowed it, it must have been his will, is a very bad thing to think, because you will accept things that does not come from God. You'll think that it's his plan some kind of way for this terrible thing to have happened to you. You know, I used to get letters from people in jail, and they would write me and tell me about how that God put them in that position, you know, and he had to do that in order to get their attention and so forth. And I don't believe that anymore than I believe I jumped off the moon last night. God didn't put them in jail. They made decisions with their life. They made decisions. They decided to break the law and got caught. And that's why they went to jail. They did wrong. They got caught. They went to jail. That didn't have anything to do with God. If the person decided, I'm not going to do this wrong, then there's nothing for them to get caught doing, and therefore they're not going to jail. That's usually what happens. I understand there are innocent people in jail who got convicted of a thing they didn't do, but that's a small number. That is a small number when you really in the grand scheme of things. So the person didn't do, the God didn't put them in jail. They put themselves there. Or the law put them there because of what they did. So how does God get blamed? Because in some people's mind, whatever their situation is, no matter what kind of decision they make, then God did it or God was in it. No, he's not. That's you. You did that. You broke that law. You committed the crime. You did whatever you did. It didn't have a thing to do with God. If a man gets in his automobile, he goes to a bar and drinks and gets drunk or wherever. He doesn't have to go to any place to do it, but a man gets drunk and then gets in his car and drives and has an accident and kills himself. Then what is that? What are we going to say about that? God allowed him? Allow that to happen, so it must have been God's will. I can imagine what people will say at the funeral. You know we loved him, but God loved him more, as though God some kind of way had something to do with the man getting drunk and killing himself. If that was God, then God is complicit in his crime. You see? Did God tell him to drink? No. Did God put the drink, the alcohol in him? No. Did God tell him to disobey the laws of the land? No. Did God tell him to get, while you're drunk now, this is a good time for you to drive? No. Did the man understand he was drunk? Yes. Did he understand the law? Yes. He violated the law, and it cost him his life. That's the way it is. So we have to stop blaming God or even attributing certain things to God that doesn't belong to him. There are certain things that God does not want to happen that does happen based on decisions and choices that you and I make. And there are some things that God wants to happen that doesn't happen. Partly because of decisions we make, but also because except we pray, if I have a need, I can't expect it to just automatically be taken care of when God is ready. I must know that I have a role to play in that, and that is I need to pray. I need to pray. But I also need to pray in faith. You see? In Matthew 7, it told us, ask. Jesus said, ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asks, receiveth. To him that seeketh to knock, and it shall be opened. Him that seeketh, he finds. So forth. Now, this is what he said in Matthew 7. And then in Matthew 21 and 22, he says, and all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. You got to believe it. So if you ask, but you're not believing, then of course you don't receive. That's the law. Don't forget, we're in the kingdom and there are laws, a rule of action that determines how things are going to happen and how they work. If you're going to pray, you have to believe. And many do not. And you hear people say, I say, I'm praying and hoping and praying. Now, what do you mean? And that's not what the Bible tells you to do. It didn't say, and hope has its place, of course, but the Bible didn't say to pray and hope as such. There is a place for it. But the Bible says we should believe in all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer. Hoping? No. I'm talking about Matthew 21 and verse 22. And all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. So wait a minute then. If that's the rule, whatever I ask in prayer, believing I shall receive, then the flip side of that is, if I ask and I'm not believing, I shall not receive. It's not like God is going to feel sorry for me and say, you know, I know you're trying your best and pat you on the shoulder, but and I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give it to you anyway. No. He governs himself by the laws that he established. He governs himself by them. Now remember that I said earlier that when I was talking about the law, when I said Jesus said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son and so forth. What I was thinking also to say about that is, because of that, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Without that person believing, they cannot be saved. They cannot be saved. So that means you and I cannot pray some prayer to God for them, for someone else, and they get saved because we prayed. Or they do something because we prayed. God made us free moral agents. We all have the right of choice and the ability to choose. Now you can choose right or you can choose wrong. It's really up to you. You can choose right or you can choose wrong. But what we do is make the choice. Now you can pray for your loved ones. You want your loved ones saved. Now personally, I don't pray, Lord, save my cousin Johnny or my sister Mary or anything. That's not the way I pray. I pray based upon what Jesus said. Jesus said that the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Now, when I pray that, that's the way I'm praying. If I'm going to pray for my cousin Johnny or my sister Mary, I'm praying, Lord, send laborers to my cousin Johnny, my sister Mary. Or whatever the case is. This is what I'm praying. Now, what is God going to do? How does God? Because remember, whosoever believes in him will not perish. Now, if it's just up to God and that you and I can pray and make that happen, then that person's free moral agency is taken away from them. That person's right of choice have been taken away from them. That person's will has been, we override their will by doing that. No. God is not going to do that. God is not going to override a person's will because if they don't want to be saved, you can't pray some prayer to make them get saved. You can't give somebody some money that's going to make them get saved. You can't give some large offering, and if you give the offering, it's going to make somebody in your family get saved. That's not going to happen. That's totally unscriptural, and it's not going to happen. What you can pray is that the Lord will send laborers to them, because that's what God told us to do. The Lord Jesus told us to do. He's the king. It's his kingdom. He's telling us how these things work. So pray the Lord of the harvest and send forth labor. So I pray for God to send laborers. Now what is God going to do? How does God respond to that? He sends laborers. He causes them to run into people, or people to come to them different ways to get the message, the gospel to them. They may reject when they first hear it, but I'm continuing to keep it on because I'm continuing to pray for God to send laborers. Not a laborer, laborers, several of them, as many as necessary. Now, is that going to make the person get saved? No. That's going to keep bringing them to a position, to a place of decision. That's what it's going to do. God is still going to leave it up to them to receive him, but he will try to influence their decision by the word of God, by people hearing, when people talk to them and tell them about the love of God, because people have a lot of issues and reasons why they don't trust God or want to believe in him, because they've had a lot of negative things happen to them and they blame God. And it's not really altogether their fault, because that's what they've been told. Anything that happens is God doing it. God is in control. He's controlling everything. He's controlling everything that happens to you, good, bad, or otherwise. And this is what people grow up believing. So when something terrible happens to them, they think God did it. Or, quote, he allowed it. And so, therefore, he must have wanted it to happen. And people need to be taught about God, the true character of God, and the true nature of God, so that when they understand the true nature of God, that he is really love, and he didn't do that. He didn't do that to you. That's not God that made that happen to you. When people understand that, they'll get a different view. And if the love of God can be shown to people who had a misconception about God, if the love of God can be shown to them, now that may make them want to turn toward God. So what's going to happen is, throughout the person's, you know, for as long as you're believing God and praying that God send laborers, he will be sending laborers. He's not going to make them get saved. God's not going to twist their arm. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's the will of God, that all come to repentance. And yet Jesus told us, I believe in the 7th chapter of Matthew, he talked about how the straight and narrow way, there was only going to be a few there, but the broad way had many. That means he's showing us many, many, many more people lost than saved, despite the will of God. God's not willing that any should perish, and yet people are perishing every day. But he told them how not to perish. Whoever believes on him, Jesus, will not perish but have everlasting life. So why are so many people perishing? Because they have not believed. Now, why haven't they believed? In some cases, because they haven't heard the gospel. That's in some cases. In other cases, they've rejected it. For whatever reason. So get the idea out of your mind that God is somehow going to violate his own law to make something happen for you without your cooperation. If the person decides, I don't want to be saved, they're not going to be saved. That's it. It's just not going to happen. And it's the same way in anything that we're praying about. So God is not going to get ready and when he, in his own time, meet your need. Present it before him. But when you ask him believing. And all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing you shall receive. The flip side again is, if you ask and you're not believing, you will not receive. Well, I prayed and I asked God. He just didn't do anything. He ignored me. No, he didn't. Matter of fact, the scripture tells us, and I think I want to turn to 1 John 5. I want to turn to it because I think we need to look at it again and see what the scripture has to say about this. Now, there was several other passages that we could look at, but I'm going to look at 1 John chapter 5 again, and I'm going to read verses 14 and 15. I want you to hear it. I want you to listen very carefully, because what it lines up perfectly with what I was saying a moment ago. Notice this, verse 14 and 15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, if we ask anything, if, notice again, we ask. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Well, hold on a minute. Wait a minute. Let's look at that one more time. This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, well, let me say it this way. This is the confidence that we have in God. I can have confidence in God, and this is the confidence. This is how I know when I pray, I receive answers. This is how I know it. This is how I know it without having to see it first. Listen to what it said again. And this is the confidence that we have in him. Wow. That if we ask, notice you still have to ask, anything according to his will, he heareth us. Well, how do you know it's according to his will? If it's according to his word, it's according to his will. God's will and his word are one. It can't be contrary to his will, and yet it's in his word. Amen. His word says, what things of, in Mark 11, 24, it says, therefore, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. I've had people ask me very interesting questions. How do I know, I want a car, but I don't know if it's God's will. I've had people ask me, they need to pray about what color car to get and all that kind of stuff. Really? Really? So God wants you to get a certain color. For what purpose? I don't know. I just want to make sure I'm in the will of God. Well, who's going to drive the car? You or God? You're going to drive the car. Who does it have to appeal to? You. Who likes it? You. Okay. That's it. Whatever color you want is fine with him. What things ever you desire when you pray. Whatever you desire when you pray. Believe that you receive them and you shall have them. I notice most people don't pray about that when it comes to relationships. They don't say, Lord, should I go with this one or not? They just shoot, ooh, he is, ooh, man. He cute, he fine, she fine. And we're driven by that. I can hear you saying amen. If not, you should be saying amen. Amen. Because I'm telling the truth. But we get off into all kinds of things. But listen to what it says. So if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. I know that I'm asking according to his will when I ask according to the word. The secret to getting your prayers answered every time is pray the word. Pray the word. Pray what the word says. Pray according to what the word says. Now, when I'm praying the word, I know it's his will. And so if I know that I prayed according to his will, then I know that he heard me. I know that he heard me. Now look at what it says after that. And if we know, verse 15, that he hear us, if we know we hear that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. I know that I have it, not because I feel it, not because I can smell it, taste it, touch it, so on and so forth. No, but because his word says it. So I act like it's mine, that I have it already. I'm not waiting to see something. I'm not waiting to feel something. You know, I've heard people say, seeing is believing. Well, that's what Thomas said. When the disciples told him, the other disciples, when he was not there, they had seen the Lord. And they saw him later, and they told him, we saw the Lord. He said, except I see him, put my finger into his nail prints and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. That's in John 20. He was not willing to believe. Did you know that your believing has to do with your will? You have to be willing to believe. I've heard people read the Bible and read things that, I don't believe that. I don't accept that. I've heard people listen to the word. I've heard people listen to me and say, I don't believe that. I don't believe that. That's their will. They don't have to believe it. You don't have to believe it. If I'm talking to somebody who needs healing, and I'm talking one-on-one, and they tell me they don't believe it, they want to argue with me about what the word says. I know it sounds hot, I know it sounds arrogant, but I tell them, isn't this interesting? You're the one sick, but you want to argue about how to be healed. And you talk to a healed man. Now, I don't mean that to be arrogant. I don't mean that to be flippant. I'm saying that to bring a person into focus. You're asking me, why would you ask me if you didn't think I had knowledge of the thing? Why'd you ask me? Just for my opinion? God didn't call me to give my opinion. He called me to preach the word, to teach the word, not to teach my opinion. If it's something that's my opinion, I say, this is my opinion. But I am called to teach the word of God, not just give my opinion. When I talk about how things work, how healings work, and how other things work, I get criticized by people that don't know the word, and they say that I'm blaming the victim. I'm not blaming the victim. This is how this works. If I tell you it works like this, that's the way it works. Where I get it from? I got it from the word. I got it from the word. So the word reveals what the law is, the rules of action. This is what has to happen. If you're going to receive from God, there's something you have to do. You have to believe. I had a gentleman call me from another country. And he needed healing, and we set it up. He was calling me once a week at a certain time every day. And believe me, that phone rang at that time. Every time he called, and we talked, and I was going over the scriptures with him. I was going over the scriptures with him, and one day, I'm telling him what he has to believe. He said, why do I have to believe? Why do I have to have faith? Seemed like that was a problem for him. What do you mean, why do you have to have faith? Because that's the law. That's the way it works. If you do not believe, you're not going to have. And all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. This is one reason why people don't receive answers. They're not believing. They're not believing. If we know that he hears us, we know that we have the petition that we desired of him. All I need to know is he heard me. And if he heard me, then I got it. That's what the scripture says. Remember, the king lays out what the laws of the kingdom is. So if he heard me, I have it. There's no such thing as he heard you and he ignored you. The question is, did he hear you? Did he hear you? This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. What does that mean then? The flip side of that, if we don't ask according to his will, he doesn't hear us. Now, someone might be saying, I don't agree with that. I don't believe that. Well, that's fine. Believe what you want. This is what the books say. I'm in the scripture. And the book is not subject to your experience. It's not subject to your experience. Whatever God said is right. whatever you say is you saying it, unless you line up with God, and it's wrong. Whatever God says is right. Your opinion matters only to you. Your feelings matter only to you. Doesn't change God one bit. Doesn't change the law. Doesn't change how it works. Now, here's something else in connection with that. Believe, Jesus said, believe that you receive them, you shall have them. He said you have to ask in faith. You have to ask in faith, not doubting. Now, very often people say that they're in faith. But let me tell you something, and this is real. One of the problems that people have is they don't know the difference between faith in the heart and mental agreement in their head. They don't know the difference. See, you can, if you raise up, you take any person that was reared in a home that took them to church and told them about God, they may not be believers. They may not be believers, as in born-again believers. If you ask them, they may be grown today. And if you ask them, do they believe that Jesus is the Lord? They would say yes. If you ask them, let's go to something real quick. Go to Romans 10. Romans chapter 10. I want you to see something. 10, and we're going to look at verses 9 and 10. Well, let's start at verse 8. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Notice it starts in your mouth. That's how it gets in your heart. Now, verse 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Now think about that for a minute. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. The next verse. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I want you to stop and think about that for a minute. So you have to believe with your heart. Now, if you ask people that I was just speaking of a moment ago, if you ask most people that raised in the house where they went to church and they heard about God and all this, you ask them, do they believe that Jesus is Lord? They would say yes. You believe he died for your sin? Yes. But are they saved? No. Why not? Because they mentally agree with it, but they did not receive it from their heart. Because if they received it from their heart, then they would have received him. But as long as they say things like, I'm not ready to be saved yet, I know I need to be saved, I'm going to do it one day, and all that, they may know mentally, but they've not believed it with their heart. That's why it's no change. When you pray, if you believe it in your heart, there's going to be change. But if you only mentally agree to it, there's not going to be any change. Most Christians, I would think all Christians, believe that God answers prayer. And yet many are concerned because they're not sure God will answer their prayers. And they pray uncertain about it. Well, you can't pray in confidence. You're not in confidence if you're uncertain. This is one of the reasons why people fail. And here's another reason why people fail to receive. They pray prematurely. I'm going to say that again. They pray prematurely. In other words, they pray for whatever they desire or need, but they do it prematurely. What do I mean by prematurely? They do it before they have established in their heart that this is what they believe. And this is one of the reasons why they pray, but they're not sure that God's going to do it. If you do that, you're not going to receive. You're not in faith. Well, I don't know if the Lord's going to do it, but I sure hope so. If it's his will, he'll do it. No, he won't. That's not what the law says. That's not the laws of the kingdom, the rule of action governing the kingdom of God. No. God tells you how things work. You can't come to him wondering if he's going to answer you. You can't do that. You pray prematurely because you don't know yet. You don't have the assurance. You remember that it says, if we ask anything according to his will, find out, first of all, that you're praying according to his will. Find out what his will is. Find out what his will is. Now, if you're sick in your body, you think God wants you sick? The Lord did this. The Lord wants to get some glory out of my life. What glory is he getting out of your sickness? He wants me to be an example to other people to show them how to go through something. I mean, that is nothing but a bunch of nonsense, unscriptural nonsense, and pride. There's something special about you that God chooses you to suffer so you can be an example of somebody else suffering. Well, then what we need Jesus for? What do we need Jesus for? We got you. By the way, what are you showing us through your suffering? What am I seeing? That you were very patient while you went down to death? That's supposed to be some kind of inspiration. Oh, she fought a good fight all the way to the end. He fought a good fight all the way to the end. Well, I'm sorry, but they didn't. A good fight is when you win. A good fight is when you win. Now, there are people that are hoping that things change. And that's what's happening. They're praying and hoping. I'm praying and I'm hoping and I'm praying. They're hoping that things change because they prayed. But they're not sure. And they keep getting worse. The thing keeps growing worse and worse and worse. And their bodies are going down. And they're still hoping that it'll work. Hoping. And then after a while, people start deciding, well, whatever the Lord's will is. I went to see a man of God years ago. And he was like a mentor to me. And many years ago. And when I saw him, one time he got sick. And I was kind of close to him. I went to his house. I was able to go to his house. And when I came in, he said to me, he said, son, I just give up and said, let the Lord have his way. Let the Lord have his way. And I said, what do you mean by that? What does that mean? I said, if the Lord's going to have his way, you're getting up out of this bed. That's what's going to happen if the Lord have his way. See, we got these ideas that God, some kind of way, wants to use your sickness or your disease for his glory. And therefore, how do you believe for it then? How do you believe to receive healing of it? You can't, because you've got the wrong idea. You got the wrong idea. And people always bring up the man that was born blind. And they said, the scripture says he's born blind for the glory of God. We don't have time today to get into that. But you need to read that very carefully. Because you are saying that God caused this person to be born and go through all his life blind just so that he could be healed in front of these people. Really? Really, don't you think that's saying that? Then you don't know the scriptures very well, and you don't know the nature of God at all. You don't know the character of God at all. That God's going to make this child have this boy born blind and go through his whole life until adulthood blind just so Jesus could come along later on and heal him. I believe that like I believe I just jumped off the moon. And that's not at all. That's not at all. That is not what Jesus was doing, and that's not what it's actually telling you. But we have to get into that at another time. So, but if you have the idea that this is what God is doing, then you, you have very little hope of being healed. If you think, for instance, that God is some kind of way holding up what you've asked for, he's holding it up. I've heard all my life people say, the Lord God, and as a matter of fact, I still hear it from ministers sometime on television and so forth. God answers prayer through it. So sometimes he says yes. And they just speak with such eloquence and just as wrong as they can be. God, sometimes he says yes. Sometimes he just says no. And sometimes he says wait. Really? Really? Now let me ask you a question. When he says wait, did he tell you how long you got to wait? Or did he just say wait? And how do you know when the waiting time is up? And by the way, when he says no, does he say why? Or does he say I got a plan and just no? No, because I know better. No, the scripture says if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know that we have the petition that we desire of him. That is the B-I-B-L-E. Now, I can't help what your experience is because the Bible is not at the mercy of your experience. The Bible is not at the mercy of your argument. It said what it said. Now, what people do is when they don't understand, when they read that and their experience is much different, then they say, well, this must not mean that because my experience was different from what this is saying. No, you need to see why your experience was different and know that the word means what it said. This is what we have to believe. This is what we have to hold to. This is what we have to stand on. Day and night, every day and every night. That's how you're going to be able to resist. That's how you're going to be able to resist the enemy. The word of God. The word of God. I tell you, there's so much. There's so much more. We're gonna bring this to a close for today. We're gonna pick up again. And actually, instead of waiting, I'm not gonna wait until next Sunday. On Wednesday, I'm gonna pick it up again and talk about this. We're gonna pick up here and go a little further. Because there's some other reasons why, and I want you to understand these things. Why people fail to receive. So we'll do part two on Wednesday, and if need be, part three on Sunday. But you need to understand some of these things, and I think it'll really help you. There's a lot of thinking out there that's inconsistent with the scripture. And when you operate in unbelief, you're not going to receive from God. It's not a matter of God not giving to you. The problem is not on the giving in. The problem is on the receiving in. That's where the issue is, where the problem is. It's on the receiving in. And so we'll talk about it later, but James talked about a double-minded man. He said, let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. Don't even think you're going to receive anything under these conditions. We'll talk about that later. But there are certain things you can forget about. It's not going to happen. Let us go to the word and believe the word and trust the word and look to the word and not to our individual experiences. I don't judge the Bible by my experience. I judge my experience by the Bible. If my experience is contrary to what the Bible says, something need to be adjusted, period. Because the Bible is right, and it's going to stay right all the time. Well, we'll pick up here on Wednesday, the Lord willing, and we thank you for tuning in. Let's pray. Father, I thank you again for the word and for those who have heard and do hear this word today in the name of Jesus. Perhaps there's somebody out there who does not know the Lord Jesus as Savior and Lord. Would like to know him. I want to give them an opportunity to come to know the Lord Jesus. If you're there and you're listening to me right now, you're watching this, you have not heard, you have not received the Lord Jesus as your Savior. You might be a churchgoer. You may go on special holidays or, you know, occasionally or once a month or whenever you feel up to it, what have you. That doesn't mean you're saved. You might even talk to God. I've even heard people claim that they have a relationship with God. You ever heard this one? I believe in God, and I'm a spiritual person, and I have a relationship with God, but I don't believe in organized religion. You ever heard that nonsense? What in the world do they mean? What do you mean, organized religion? Ask those people when you hear them say that nonsense, what do they mean? Do they mean they don't believe the Bible? They don't follow what the Bible teaches? I guarantee you, they don't believe the Bible. Guarantee you. I'll guarantee you such people think that some of it they can accept and other part of it they can reject. But if any of it is bad, all of it is bad. If any of it is bad, all of it is bad. If you got some meat that's spoiling and it's starting to smell bad, you ain't going to start pushing, cutting off the parts that smell bad and leave the rest and cook it and eat it. Not if you're smart. If there's any of it bad, all of it is bad. So if you have not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you're not saved. No matter what your church attendance is like or anything like that. And so I quoted scripture, we read scripture a little earlier, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And this is a heart thing on a heart level. That means you come to a decision inside. Jesus is Lord, and I need to be saved. I cannot save myself. My works are not going to save me. My goodness is not going to save me. I need Jesus, and he is the one that can save me, the only one. And God gave him and raised him from the dead. He gave his life for me, and God raised him from the dead. I believe that, and I receive his sacrifice for my sins. That's what that's about. If you were willing to do that, that's how you're saved. If not, you're not saved. It doesn't matter how much money you give to the church or to any preacher. It doesn't matter how many charities you give to. You may get points and pats on the back by people. They may sing your praises in the public, but it doesn't count to God. It doesn't mean a thing. That's not going to save you. It's not going to save you. You'll still be lost. You're still lost. Not will be, because you're already condemned if you don't believe. So right where you are, if you accept what I'm telling you now from the Word and you want to be saved, I want you to slip your hand up where you are. I want you to close your eyes and say to the Lord, oh God, I believe that Jesus is Lord. I also believe that he is the only way to you. I believe also that you raised him from the dead so that I might be saved. I receive the Lord Jesus as my Savior, as my Lord, as my only hope of eternal life. And right now, by faith, I pass from death to life. My sins are cleansed, and I receive the free gift of righteousness in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you meant that, it's done just like that. All your past is wiped away and you start fresh right now before God. Great news. Hallelujah. And let us know about your decision so we can help you in your walk with God. Praise God. Now let's pray for those. Maybe someone, people having needs and suffering and so forth. I want to pray also for them. Father, We thank you for your holy word. Thank you for your love. You are a loving God. You are love. You care for us. You are passionate and compassionate for us and about us. You desire the best for us. We suffer sometimes needlessly by things based upon what we don't know or decisions we've made and things we've done. But it is your desire for us to be at peace. It's your desire for us to be well. And I pray, Father, that you stretch forth your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders will be done in the name of your holy child, Jesus. I pray that you touch that man, that woman, that boy, and that girl. Touch that individual in need right now. Meet that need. Touch that family. Bring healing to the sick. Bring comfort to those who have lost loved ones. Bring peace to those who are depressed. In the mighty name of Jesus, send laborers to those who are lost. Send laborers into your harvest. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I want to thank you for your time. And now I want to ask everyone to please give your tithe and your offerings to help us, because the bills keep going. That's one thing. The coronavirus did not stop. It didn't stop the bills from coming in. They still come in. And the ministry still has things that we have to take care of. And so we thank you. Full Gospel, you know what you do. So I'm going to ask you to do what you do. Give your offerings by the different ways that you can give. And, you know, Givelify and several other ways that we have that you may give. PayPal is another one. So we'll have that up on the screen on our page. So we want you to give. Give until it helps. If you are in a different church, I trust that you're supporting your church, because your church needs your help. Please support your church. Support your church. If you have anything extra and you can give, then join in and give to our ministry. If we've been a blessing to you, then it's only right for you to be a blessing also. Thank you. God bless you. And I'll see you on Wednesday by the grace of God. Amen.